Yes. Hello, and welcome to the second episode of J-Squad News. For this episode, we're going to be more focused on a particular gaming conference that has taken place in the past week. And so, with that in mind, I shall now present with you the menu for you to digest for this episode.
J-Squad member MMJ gives a report on the E3 conference. He also has a brief interview with another J-Squad member, LDR100, about his thoughts on the E3 conference. I have a discussion with some J-Squad members about how they feel Smash 5 will have an impact upon release.
Before we head into our next topic, I have very exciting news for you, the public. I am pretty sure you will be pretty amazed with what it is I'm about to show you. Enjoy!
A new discovery, leaving the top scientists baffled. An effort culminating in the greatest of instruction to advance society further than we ever believed was fathomable. Who these great minds are that could spawn technology that will put our world as we once knew it to shame. I read as many journal papers as I could find to gain some sort of understanding, but I do not get it. I cannot get it. I fail to understand it!
I just don't understand!
And how could you? This phenomenon hangs in the balance of human comprehension as we know it! Modern politics, scientific research, advanced historical literature, the core physical, mathematics and sociological implications this has on societal structure remains an enigma. My exercise cut short in light of this pounding information. And now, I present to you all the blinding, godforsaken discovery which will rebalance the theoretical space-time continuum itself!
I mean, it works with red apples too! In any case, we're going to head straight into MMJ's segment as he's going to report on the E3 conference itself. So, heading it straight over to MMJ.
Thank you, Crashio. So, E3 was a four-day event, with companies such as Square Enix showing off Kingdom Hearts 3, Sony showing off Last of Us 2, Microsoft showing off Gears of War 5, Bethesda showing off Fallout 76, EA showing off Battlefield 5, and Ubisoft showing off Assassin's Creed Odyssey. We also had Nintendo, which I had to say for last, showing off Super Smash Bros. Ultimate for the Nintendo Switch. I went to a fellow J-Squad member's house and I asked him a few questions about how he felt E3 was for him. And here's what he has said.
I'd say with Square Enix, I was more looking forward to Kingdom Hearts, as I followed that series for a long time and we waited too damn long for this next game. We had 2.5, 2.5, we have too damn many in between. I'm still waiting for this game, it's still not out. So for Square Enix, definitely Kingdom Hearts 3. I still don't believe it's coming out next year. I'd say for Bethesda, I'd say Fallout 76, because I've heard lots of things about the game. I haven't played Fallout myself personally, but I've heard lots of things, and it seems like a solid, great game. For Sony, I'd say I'm looking more forward to The Last of Us 2, as, again, I haven't played the game, but I've heard so much good things about it that it seems like a pretty hype announcement from them, and everybody like is looking forward to that too, as how solid the first game was. I'd say for Microsoft, I'd say the announcement for Jump Forces was really, really good, because after Jump Ultimate Stars didn't do as well, but the one on DS did well, I wonder if they would be able to like pick it up with this new game, as it looks really good, it looks interesting, and it can add more Shonen Jump characters to it, as it's like more anime's been announced and more things get into the game. And with Ubisoft, I'd say Assassin's Creed, because again, it's just a solid series and it looks really good. And of course, the MVP for me, Nintendo, we have Smash, which I'm definitely looking forward to. I guess I'm a bit biased about Smash Bros, but I'm really looking forward to Smash. It looks very solidly made. I'm really happy it's not a port, and it's a brand new game with new mechanics and stuff. And yeah, that's basically my opinion.
For our next segment, I decided to have a discussion with four other J Squad members about the upcoming release, Smash 5, or known as Smash Ultimate. In a Discord voice chat, I had a semi-reasonable discussion with these members, and this is what I'm going to show to you right now.
Question on the mic, and I'm in Discord voice chat with a bunch of J Squad members, and we're here to talk about Smash 5. So, to the people in the voice chat right now, I'm trying to ask you a question up in here. So I'm saying, how do you feel about Smash 5 now that we've seen quite a few gameplay about it? How do you guys feel about its competitive viability?
Well, I saw Bayer roof someone, so you know it's already over.
I mean, to be fair, they did roof a melee player who's not used to melee. I mean, to not used to SDIing Bayonetta's combos.
Did they not roof her? Did Ridley not go off the top?
Ridley did go off the top, but Ridley is a big frame character, so you know, very likely to be taken off the top, especially with the stage had a low ceiling.
Mr. PG Bear said that Sakurai looked at that combo and shook his head in disgust. So that basically means that upon release, Bayo is going to get a bit more
deleted,
a bit more, a tiny bit of that. So, but yeah.
Why is Klaus Bear safe?
Talking about Smash 5.
Smash Ultimate, obviously.
I mean, I think in Ultimate, people need to realize that. Obviously, it's still at the stage where it's not even out yet, so there's still changes.
That is a fantastic point, Zone. So, fantastic.
Nothing's really been finalized aside from the characters and the moves and stuff. But yeah.
Yeah, they could still add Valorigi actually. So I do.
Okay. So what? How do you guys feel about the new power shielding situation with the letting go of shield to power shield?
I mean,
I think it's better.
It means you can punish a lot quicker. Like.
Oh yeah.
From what
in
I saw.
Terms of, like, It's definitely something that newcomers will get used to more easily, I feel.
Definitely something.
I just think they put that in because it favors aggression, basically.
It benefits characters that get trapped in shield or like slow out. Let's look at Greninja, for example. He's out of shield grab and Smash 4 isn't that quick. So if he can like shield and then like parry like a quote unquote safe move on shield, then he can get that dash grab afterwards, you know. And there's also now invincibility. I think that's what I read today, that there's invincibility as well, so that probably incorporates a new aspect of the game where if you get that parry, that initial parry, then you can probably go through certain moves and you know.
Okay, so when a character receives like a strong attack, they get launched almost like a balloon state where they fly super fast and then eventually the momentum almost just comes to a complete halt. How do you guys feel about this?
It's the illusion of speed, man. They're clearly trying to tailor towards melee players, I think. Especially if you saw Ganon now, not only does he have his melee design, but like most of his aerials auto-cancel.
A lot of areas like across the board have...
Yeah, just in general as well. So, and especially with them choosing like four melee players rather than just eight Smash players for the invitation. I think they're trying to appeal to that melee audience. I think we even saw in the demo, we saw, not in the demo, but in the reveal, we saw Sakurai with Mega Man. He did like a jump cancel glide toss with Mega Man. Sakurai himself, no, with Link rather, which is pretty crazy.
Okay, so do you think that any melee players are really going to give this an actual shot and join the Smash Ultimate competitive scene?
You know what melee players are like, though.
I don't think any of the ones who don't juggle games already will. To be a perfect
they're the kind of guys to not try out a game simply because a certain mechanic isn't in it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I reckon they'll try it out, of course, but to them, melee's melee. And that's fair enough, like, you know. But
does anyone believe that Smash Ultimate will hold a candle to the melee competitive scene? By that I mean, you know, later in its lifespan, rake in the same number of entrants and, you know, really maintain that competitive thrive?
I don't know if I'm wrong with
Smash 4 basically did that,
yeah,
so yeah.
Honestly.
So that's a, that was not the greatest point.
Thing is, the difference is with Smash 4, it did it for like a bit, and then it slowly just like quietened down.
No, yeah. So it's quietened down.
Melee kind of stood on top just for most of Smash 4.
Think about it, like it really quietened down when we actually knew a new game was coming.
It was a combination of the game's meta and the new game coming.
Okay. Well, it seems like we're running out of time, so thank you for the J Squad members for talking to me about Smash 5 and its core mechanics and the scene.
We could have gone way further with this. Yeah.
I don't want to take up too much of the audience's time. It's been over 5 minutes already, almost 6 minutes. So, you know,
5 minutes is nothing. They showed that game for 3 days.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure everyone loved it, Justice. Okay, so this is Lucrecio signing off. Real good thanks to all the J Squad members. Okay, so I'm just going to stop the recording before I make a complete fool of myself.
Follow me on Twitter. And now we return to
the final segment.
He didn't even mention as a top.
Okay, so it got a little bit messy towards the end there, but what can you do in a voice chat like that? In any case, that's gonna be all for today, unfortunately. Hopefully we'll be releasing another episode next week for Sunday. That's pretty much all for me, because that's pretty much all we have time for. I strongly hope that you have enjoyed today's episode, and we will see you all next week. And never forget, we are repping J Squad all day. I repeat, we are repping J Squad all day. Thank you.